I think each show that we've done has gotten a lot bigger and better. We have so many big personalities, and they mesh and mingle really well in this class. And I think Aladdin showcases that, and I'm really excited to see where this program goes.
Nation. This is Doug Winters, your host, and 1-0 in districts. Again, welcome to the next edition of the Glenpool Warriors Coaches Show. I'm here with Coach Steve Edwards. Welcome, Steve.
Thanks, Coach. Glad to be here. Thank you.
1-0 in districts.
It's always got to feel better than 0-3, right? Feels better than 0-3.
What an exciting homecoming game. 6-0, comes down to the end. I know your heart was racing.
Oh, without a doubt. It was two young football teams. The Edison's kind of young this year, so were we. But the kids just battled back and forth. We had a lot of mistakes here and there. But, you know, to come out on top really feels good, you know, right at the end there and have that goal line stand. And the kids come out victorious. You know, it's always emotional and the kids are jacked up. And, you know, they did something that no other team in Glenpool history has done, and that's win a 5A district game. So that's pretty cool. Something they can always remember.
Always. Special memory, especially on homecoming.
Oh, yeah. A lot of folks in the stands. Tons of people. They all want to come see the queens and the pretty dresses and everybody dresses up and the band play. So it brings people from all, you know, people come back. What's really getting neat now is after being here for 20 years, you see people start treating this like their hometown now. And that's really neat. I saw a lot of guys that went to school here and I've coached or maybe their parents. And they're all coming back and they come to homecoming. So, you know, you didn't used to see that a lot. And we do now. And that's really cool to see.
My son included. He was excited to see the boys win.
Good.
So,
good deal.
First, what we'd like to do today is maybe take a look at some film.
Okay. Yeah.
And maybe ask you some questions about the film and
you bet.
What was going on that maybe the fans would like to know. Maybe you don't want to tell everything, but you know, maybe some reflection on the game.
Yeah. You know, like I say, it was homecoming night, and you know, nobody likes homecoming except probably no football coaches hardly ever like homecoming. No. But it is neat after the game. Hopefully, you have a win, and you get to go. You get to see some of those people you don't get to see all the time.
Well, here we are. Again, great drone footage from the guys.
That's really cool. You know, we've got about 70 or 80 players there. The kids in the elementary, and you can see some of the jerseys on the sidelines, and the people coming into the game. You know, it was a great night for football.
Nice,
yeah. Just finally got some cool weather, and
look, it's almost already paying. They took this footage early.
So wow.
There's people lined up back behind there, and
really neat.
With the opening kickoff.
Well, you know, they like to kind of do a deep onside kick, and they kick the ball to Jake Zickafoos. We kind of had a little numbering system up there. We were going to try to pick all the guys up that we could and get past that first wave, and we did. We ended up getting about a 25-yard return, so that was really cool.
Defensively, you had to worry about Mays. Tremendous athlete,
right.
Quarterback for Edison. What was Coach Smith and your game plan to stop them defensively?
Well, you know, you really can't expect, you know, he's kind of the prototypical what you're seeing in colleges now that Louisville's running, and, you know, you see these running quarterbacks and guys that can scramble. He's that kind of guy at our level, and very athletic. Division I, I think he's already had some Division I offers as an athlete. So you'll see him at the quarterback spot, knowing he's going to handle the ball every snap. He might pick it up and go at any moment. You have to be aware of where he's at on the field all the time. I think it really helps us a little bit when he's right at quarterback, because now everybody can see him. So it almost helped us a little bit, knowing right where he was all the time.
They moved him in week two, didn't they?
Yes, yeah.
They wanted to get the ball in the athlete, best player's hand.
Exactly, and I think that's a good idea. I understand why they did it.
Big plays here, I believe. This may be Jake Ziegfuss.
That's I think that was Brent. I think it was Brent Ziegfuss, and our outside linebacker, maybe Jake. Great job. Those guys kind of had his number all night. You know, we kept them kind of contained. They did throw a deep ball late on us in the fourth period that was kind of pretty effective.
We saw some defense highlights here from the first half. You had to be pleased, but it was a struggle. It seemed like on the stat sheet we were really winning in the first half. The defense was really keeping Edison in check, and we seemed to be moving the ball, but it was still 0-0.
Exactly, not finishing. And, you know, that's sometimes that can be a syndrome with a young team. We'd put in some different formations. We thought we could take advantage with these guys. And in using those formations, some of the shifts we were doing and shifting three players at once or shifting and then motioning a guy back, you know, you're moving three and four players at a time, can get kind of confusing. With some of the cadence we use, we have different cadence that we use, and that's just to snap the football, really, basically is a simple way to say that. But in changing the cadence, we were getting the ball snapped too early, we get the ball snapped too late, people were moving, the ball's not moving. We had some issues there. So
work in progress.
Work in progress, and we corrected those things this week. You know, it's really been kind of neat, Doug. Each week, as we've done something, we've spent the next week correcting it, trying to get it right. And
that's coaching.
That's coaching. And I can honestly say that the issues that we've had as we've moved along, we have fixed. The things that are within our control. Some of it is outside your control, as you know in coaching. But the things that we can handle and that our kids can handle, they've grasped and they've fixed. So I'm starting to see us. We've got a great week of practice this week. I'm starting to see some of the results of the things that we're getting. We're playing more competitive football, which we should be.
And talking with you at half, you seemed very frustrated, especially when you had first and goal at the 7. And,
wow.
And you had those success, you know, consecutive penalties. And you know, took you out of field goal range.
You know, you go out there with them on a timeout. I remember going out there with a timeout, and they're all frustrated. They're all at each other's throat going, my gosh, what are we doing? And you got to remind them, hey, guys, it's just football. You got to still have fun doing this, but it's just football. Pump your brakes a little bit. Let's get back out there and try to execute what we're doing, and don't get so keyed up. I mean, you need to play at a high level, but emotional teams go up and down, but inspired teams stay up, you know, for a longer period of time. So you try to inspire each other with your play, you try to inspire each other with words and actions. But if you're really emotional, you're either way up or you're way down. You're at the top of each peak, and it causes guys to make mental mistakes.
If you don't mind me asking, what adjustments did you guys talk about? Did you feel good coming into the second half being 0-0?
Really just trying to, you know, we tried to jerk a knot in them when we got in there at halftime, to be honest with you, because there really wasn't anything we needed to do extra. Our defense was at that time, was playing pretty well, was getting them stopped, giving us opportunities with the football. We were our own worst enemy. You know, we're jumping off sides, we're holding, yes, and just go, hey, relax a little bit. It's just a football game. Let's go out there and play and execute the best we can and see how that goes. So second half, they ended up kind of doing that. We seemed like we could always move the ball in spurts. We weren't just, you know, chipping off great big chunks of yardage. But we were moving the ball in spurts. We were hanging on to it. We were keeping their offense, which is very explosive, off the field.
Yes.
And that was a big part of what we had to do.
Well, let's look at the scoring play here. Can you describe the play?
I'm trying to remember. Let's take a look here. We're in, for us, this is our Auburn formation. We got right motion. What we were doing is when we'd motion across, we'd put a guy, what we call jet motion, bring a guy across the formation. They would lower somebody out of the secondary to come down and cover the possibility of a jet sweep on that situation. So as that guy comes across, they're lowering their secondary down, which gave us an open receiver, open area in the flats to throw a slant route. So it was jet motion, and that was Jake Adams on the catch. And did a great job of second effort right at the very end of just getting into the end zone.
He was hungry for a touchdown.
Exactly.
It was really good coverage. It's a great ball.
Right.
Colton Kane is right on the money.
Right on the money.
But as soon as he touched it, he got hit.
Yeah.
And he stood up and then gave that extra effort.
Extra effort to get in the end zone.
To get in the end zone. Yeah, he told me a nice counter to that jet sweep.
Yes, you know, he came to me after the score, and I go, "Hey, man, great job." And he goes, "Hey, I was trying to make up." He'd be dropped a hitch route, was right in his hands earlier, and he was feeling bad about it. So he said, "Hey, I had to make up for it." So great job on that, Jake. Great job.
So you score here,
right?
Don't convert.
Yeah.
Bad snap.
Yeah, and
you hope it doesn't come back to bite you.
Yes. Well, you know, Mason Bennett has been our long snapper. Well, Mason got injured in the Tahlequah game, and he's been out for a few weeks. He's back this week, but so we've been trying different snappers, you know, and we've been blessed. We had old John Kane that snapped since he was like, you know, and your son snapped for us too, you know, and John was a long snapper for us since he was a freshman and kind of got spoiled of that for the last 3 or 4 years. And then, so now we're kind of a snapper short, and Roman Gray was our snapper there, and he just didn't have a good grip on the ball, kind of dribbled it back. We missed it. In the back of your mind as a coach, you're going, "Oh gosh, I hope it didn't come back and haunt us," you know.
Exactly.
And unfortunately, I can see the clips you got up here. That could, you know, that's what we're thinking right now.
So it's 6-0.
6-0.
You get the ball, but they, I believe, get a turnover, interception.
Right.
And so now you're praying for the defense to
exactly.
Hang on.
Exactly. Hang on, man. And, you know, they've thrown that long bomb
fourth
down the field.
12,
yeah,
it?
4th and 12, and the kid just jumps out of his shoes and catches the ball.
Good coverage.
I thought we were all on it, but he just out jumped us and got the football. Now it puts him down in 4-down territory, which, you know, we'd like to have a little more space between us and the end zone, but we didn't. And so, yeah, I'm trying to see the player.
I believe this is the 3rd down play.
Mm-hmm.
And, again, it's fine, waning seconds. They're going to sweep.
It's a great call here by their coaching staff. You know, they're going to run a kind of a sweep pass back in the end zone. So, I mean, if you're the corner on that side, you can't be right. If you stay back and cover the guy, then this kid runs a sweep in for a touchdown. If you come up and stop him, he throws it over his head. So there's just no way to be right.
It's a really good call out. They called a timeout there to set up that play, and luckily it's a little underthrown.
Yeah.
And
he bobbled it.
So,
hey, everything happens for a reason, right?
I mean, now, this is the play that decides the ball game.
Right.
If we stop them, we'll go victory formation, which is always a great.
Oh, my great favorite formation. Yeah.
Favorite formation. And so let's take a look at this 4th down game on the line play.
Well, you know, we really thought great play there by Brendan Ballard and Gage Height coming in. Brendan comes over the top of the guy and is really a smart move. You'll see a lot of young kids tip a ball up in the end zone. Well, that just lets the guy have another chance of catching it. And they've been coached to knock the ball down. So when you swat at the ball, knock it down so somebody's not going to tip it up.
In this highlight, who is the corner that's covering the deep receiver that's in the back? He breaks on the pass to
yeah,
get
that's,
in.
That's Gage Height, yes.
Boy,
just
he did
sophomore.
A wonderful job here because the guy has his hands on it.
Yeah.
And they dislodge it. On the,
right.
Both of them hit.
Well, you know,
you always want to teach that, right?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. And, you know, to get your hands where their hands are at and rake arms, you know, you got to do it legally or they get another set of downs, you know. So you can't go in there and just start knocking them around. But we really felt like on that last play, their quarterback was going to handle the ball. And we thought it might be an option, give him the opportunity to throw it or run it. So they ran sprint out, which Boots really good on the goal line, a bootleg pass. But they chose to sprint out and throw and had the kid open. But our kids just made a great play on the ball and just denied the catch. So great win. You know, we're getting victory formation after that. And run the clock off and get out of it with our first win. So it felt really good.
Give me some on that. I was excited.
I
wasn't as excited as Coach Cleveland.
Yeah.
If you guys look back on this highlight, Coach Cleveland's jumping up and down, looking for someone
yeah.
to hug.
Looking for somebody to grab.
And nobody wants to hug him.
Well,
he's
looking at him out there. His vertical leap is about an inch and a half. And
so
it's not real way up in the air, but I saw him.
Did you
see? Yeah, I saw that. That's pretty good.
He's wanting to hug. He's thinking he's playing again.
Yeah.
And I'm sure everybody, I was excited on the sideline for the boys and
yeah.
the coaching staff and for the school. It was a great moment. Again, a hard-fought victory.
Yes.
1-0 in the district.
Right.
So, let's talk about this week.
We
like celebrating, but
right.
we can't rest on our laurels.
Exactly. That's the thing about football. You got 1 week to prepare. And I like it because it's a lot like the classroom. I mean, it's a lot of times you might have a test on Friday. You got a week to prepare for it. Now, you got a choice on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And that what you're going to make on that test on Friday is what you do on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And I like that aspect of it and really try to burn that into our kids that, look, man, you're either going to be very confident Thursday or Friday. Doesn't it feel good when you walk into your classroom and you're ready to take the test? You're going, I know this stuff. You ain't tricking me, man. You ain't going to get, so I'm going to do great on this test. I think that's an exciting feeling to have, is preparation is going to dictate your performance, your preparation. So what I do Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday is the game's played Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And if you can get your kids to operate at a higher level than, say, the Durant Lions when we go down there, if we've been operating all this week at a higher level and the right things happen for us, 5A's for us is talent-wise is kind of a push. I think we've got a very talented team. But when you get in these 5A schools that are a lot, the towns are a lot bigger than us right now. Yeah. I mean, we're growing, but I mean, we're suffering from some growing pains. So when you start matching talent for talent, they're going to have people that can match right back up with you. And sometimes in some of the smaller classes, if you've got three or four or five guys that are really talented and they're just head and shoulders above, you're going to find that extra kid that they just can't match up with. With Durant, they've got a big, nice size line up front. I mean, they're going about 235, 240 up front. They've got a sophomore quarterback, but a real dandy running back. I forget his name, but a dandy little running back. They're going to be in the shotgun most of the time. Zone read, the quarterback will run it a little bit. So running spread offense and throwing the ball around. Pretty good kicking game. They do some trickery stuff in the kicking game. It's really keeps you on your toes. You got to be ready for it. You got to practice it. But I know their staff's been there a while, and these guys do a really good job. You know, they're close to they're so close to Texas. You know, they probably. You know, I'm sure they get a lot of input from the people down south, and there's some good football played around that area.
I've coached against Durant football wise, and boy, the tailgate, the community coming out, it's an atmosphere, an event. That's a long trip. Do you worry about long trip fatigue?
Well, I know
it's a whole different routine.
Coach. Normally, I've been kind of against against spending money on chartered busing. And even when we were in the playoffs going to state championship, we'd roll up in that Glenpool Public Schools yellow bus. You know, that's how we traveled. And I thought, you know, there's something to be said for that. But this time of year, I couldn't jeopardize it being so hot that the game was over before we ever got there. And our kids just melted out on a 3-hour bus ride. So we raised money. We fundraised for with our booster club, in order to get charter buses to take down there, take the kids. So I think they're pretty excited about the mission. We've talked about, we call it the Durant mission, and so that's what we're on. We're on a mission to going down there. We're going to load up that big bus and put everybody on it and load down and head down there in comfort and air conditioning. And so I'm hoping that'll help us. But Durant, like I said, they've had some traditional teams, and it's a community that loves their football. It's a college town, so you've got Southeastern down there, and you know, it's a tradition-rich area, and people like their sports. They love their children. They come out and support. I know it'll be tough for some of our Warrior family to get down there, but if you can, it'll be a good football game, I think. I think we're going to show up well. We're getting, we've got both our linebackers. We're at 100% full health right now. We've got all our linebacking core back in. Mason Bennett, who had a little trouble with his knee, is back this week, so he's back in the fold. So, we're going to be running at full tilt. We've had a great week of practice. You know, winning one, you know, kind of puts air. Yeah, it gets a lot better, man. And everybody's been jacked up about getting out there. And the coaches are working hard, which they always have. And I got a great staff of guys. And the kids are not, you know, you need these wins so they don't just go, they don't get frustrated with what you're doing. So we've proved we can do it if given the opportunity.
Well, we sure want to thank you for your time, Coach.
Thanks, Coach.
We wish you good luck.
Hey, thank you. I need it.
You bet. And Warrior Nation, we want to thank you for the Booster Club and the community supporting and giving money so these guys can take the nice bus down. And, again, we hope there's a caravan of folks that meet up and go down to Durant safely. And we want to fill the stands. So this is Doug Winter saying goodbye, Warrior Nation, and see you next week.